Digital Innovation Hub Tour. I welcome you from a very glorious sunny day in Hamilton, Scotland. I'm Jon Ozanne and I will be your host for this tour. Balfour Beatty is committed to driving out CO2 production from its construction methods. It's also committed to making the changes it needs across all of its business processes. We've refreshed our sustainability strategy, Building New Futures, which sets out ambitious and bold targets for the materials that we use, our environment, and the communities that we work within. And with 26,000 employees across the globe and thousands of supply chain partners, it's clear that our efforts need to go way beyond the confines of a construction site, and everybody can play a part in making those targets a reality. Our digital hub here is hosted at the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre during COP26. They are showcasing the very latest in low carbon construction innovations, and our hub here is a really great example of how we bring those targets in our strategy to life. I'm going to be taking you on a tour and showing you how we're using data and digital to keep our staff safe, to run our jobs efficiently as we possibly can, minimising rework, minimising waste, and therefore overall improving our sustainability. I'll be joined by James Veitch, our Director of Digital and Data, and by Callum Butter, a local digital expert working on our regional construction jobs. Let's go inside. The first thing that you'll see over my shoulder when you step into the Innovation Hub is an example of what we would call our modular mission control. The modular mission control can be used across all aspects of our work in Balfour Beatty, but what's key is locally projects can tailor it so they can control the things that their job demands. Safety, the number of resources and people on site, how we use our plant and our fleet the most optimally, and how we measure progress of our construction jobs are all key components of our mission control solution. James, you've recently been key in driving forward the education of how we use data to better manage construction. Perhaps you can tell us a few more details about what we're seeing here.
Yeah, thanks, John. What you're seeing here is actually a window into a number of capabilities. We spent a lot of time over the last couple of years working with projects to really identify what's important to them, work to standardise, to integrate, to be able to provide them with data that's relevant to their context. They don't need to worry about pulling information together, we can surface it to them. On the screen here, I suppose you'd start on the left. Safety's always been our licence to operate. We've got an industry-leading observations application, which we make available to everyone. And what you can see is the observations that have been raised against this project, whether they're good practice, they're a close call. If you're treating this as a control room, this is actually being driven live into the environment, and you can see that's just updated with a new observation, and the control room has been notified that actually it's good practice. Moving around, we can see the contractors on site or the labour levels. We can actually zoom in, we can change the time that we're looking at, we can see that broken down by supplier, by trade. You're able to react sort of on demand. You're not reliant on feedback from the sites to tell you we don't have the right resources. You can see that here.
And I think if you were visiting us here in Construction Scotland's Innovation Centre or at our Shots site just a few miles up the road, you would see the MSite Technologies, where they're using biometrics, facial scans or mobile telephony to give you secure access into sites and doing things like temperature checking as you pass through. James, back to the kind of data. The theory is fantastic, but what about in practice? Are we actually seeing benefits from using data in this way?
Well, I think, ironically, the least interesting of the visuals is actually the most important in that context for sustainability. This one here, JCB LiveLink, we may have touched on beforehand. This is something which we've worked at with JCB. So part of the challenges of Tier 1 is we don't own all of the plant on our sites. We lacked that level of visibility previously. We either had our own plant, we might hire it in, the supply chain might bring their own. That was consistent across all of our projects. So we worked with JCB to sort of aggregate telematics, standardise it across all OEMs. And the The irony was we went after this with a hypothesis that we had too much plant on site. It wasn't being utilised effectively, and really we should be reducing cost. The data that it threw up actually indicated behavioural aspects that we could work on instead. So on the first project that we introduced this onto, we actually identified that the engines were idling too much. Machines were in use where really there shouldn't have been any activity. On that first project alone, we reduced engine idling by 50%, saved around 100,000 litres of fuel. That equates to approximately 300 tonnes of CO2. So one of those things where actually just looking at the data and putting that in the hands of the individuals who know best, they were able to sort of localise to their own requirements there.
And that's one project. You aggregate that up across a number of projects and the benefits are going to be sizeable and significant, aren't they?
Exactly. And actually, an example of this working at scale, we move across to the map here. This is we have the same information available for our fleet. So this is master note data for a county, Herefordshire, where we provide a lot of outsourced work on behalf of the local council. You can see all of our assets in the field. The control room there in Herefordshire is probably second to none in my view. They're able to use this information to really react to the situation on the ground. We have an example only a week or so ago where for a fuel spill, the first responders on the ground were able to remote in, dial the control room in and really work through that.
I probably should have mentioned as well, this is all internally generated solutions from within Balfour Beatty that are really beginning to make impact on construction sites. We've got this mission control hosted in a cabin, which can be dropped onto a construction site, but equally it can be used in remote context. In fact, what you can see here is a live feed of our shot site, circa 10, 15 miles away from where we are in Hamilton today. I'm not going to go into too much detail about what you can see there, because at shots we've been running a sustainability evolution showcase for the last couple of weeks and for the rest of COP. And the details on the cameras here have been part of a previous live feed, and I believe next Tuesday at 2 p.m. we'll be doing another live feed from shots showcasing how we sustainably do site setup. But the point being is we can live feed and manage the operations of a construction site remotely. Now we don't have to be on site. I just want to move on to a different part of the Innovation Hub now, and an area for which we're not only very, really pleased with our progress, but we're super impressed by our own internal capabilities to generate immersive environments. Some people watching the video might think of that in terms of virtual reality or augmented reality, but we use them specifically for two scenarios. Rehearsal, you know, what we rehearse, we get right first time on construction sites, eliminating costly rework, eliminating additional use of materials, or we use them in training scenarios so our operators are safe doing things for reality. James, tell us a little bit about what Callan is doing and seeing here.
So in many ways, this is the embodiment of sort of the measure twice, cut once philosophy. So Callan is currently working through a training simulator for installing a gantry. What it's doing is it's encouraging him to remember the correct sequencing, and then what it will do is it will visualise that for him so that when he steps on site for the first time, he's actually able to understand what he's seeing around him, not just what's happening, what's expected to happen next. And I think that's really important in an industry where we've got a well-publicised skill gap. We're trying to upskill all of our resources. There's potentially not enough people to do the work that's coming down the line. So in many ways, this... it's just a reflection of what we want to be doing more often. So the challenge for us at the moment is on standardising tasks. Once you've standardised those tasks, I'd love to see a library of this sort of capability so that people can really practice in advance of going out on sites, because it just keeps it all safe.
Fantastic story, and of course a really good example of the evolution of skills that we require within our business. This particular environment that Callan's using, I think, was developed by our in-house team in Bangalore.
Yeah, that's right.
Fantastic. Brilliant, thank you. Now, if you were joining us live here at the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre, the other side of the hub, you'd also be able to get insight into the plethora of activities and case studies that we've been generating around better use of materials, smarter ways of working to improve our sustainability. That could be from the use of green technologies on site, or it could be the case study of how corporately our strategy now includes only buying remanufactured laptops for our staff in offices and sites. That strategy means that we are avoiding the waste from disposing of perfectly good laptops. We're avoiding the harmful process of mining for raw materials that go into the production of new laptops. And for every laptop we purchase, five trees are planted on behalf of Balfour Beatty, making it truly a carbon and a net zero end user computing strategy. Last year, that was 25,000 trees that were planted for Balfour Beatty. Now, planting trees and the laptop strategy isn't going to get us where we need to be alone, but it's one example of the plethora of activities that are occurring across the business. Now, you may wonder, where do all the great ideas come from? They don't all come from James with fantastic ideas and solutions like Mission Control. We listen to our staff, and one of the ways we listen to our staff is through My Contribution. My Contribution is our internal ideas and innovation programme. Last year, we ran a sustainability campaign with My Contribution, and that generated over 770 ideas from our staff across the business about things that we can be doing to progress our agenda. It really is a bottom-up approach to innovation. And of course, when you then ally that with the top-down corporate initiatives, we're beginning to make absolutely fantastic strides. That's really all I've got time to show you. On behalf of Callum, James and myself, thank you for watching. If you're watching this on YouTube and you've liked the video, please click like. Please subscribe to the channel. In fact, subscribe to the channel and like, even if you didn't like the video, you're going to love the next one. And it's all that's left for me to say, really, is make sure you tune into the next live feed, which will be Tuesday, the 9th of November at 2 p.m, where we'll be covering how we sustainably cover our site setups. So just from me to say thank you for watching and goodbye from a very sunny Hamilton.